Hello everyone, thank you so much for joining me on my channel. I'm Danny Paranormal, and today we're looking at ghost stories and ghosts. We'll see what we find. I still have the sniffles. I hate it, but let's get going on these videos. Weird. That's crazy. All right.
What is the creepiest thing your kid ever said?
When my daughter was three, she came in my room in the middle of the night, woke me up, and said, "Mommy, can you please get the little girl out of my room?" And I'm sleeping. I'm like, "What little girl?" She's like, "The little girl. She's jumping on my bed. She wants to play with me. She won't get out of my room." I'm like, "Oh, just sleep with me." So she slept with me. The next day, I didn't think anything of it. Then she comes to me and says, "I'm so sick of Daddy moving my toys around in my dollhouse. He comes in my room and plays with my dollhouse and moves them all around." I'm like, "I highly doubt your father's doing that. He probably banged into it by accident, making your bed or something." This went on for pretty much every morning. Somebody's rearranging my dollhouse. Didn't think anything of it at all. The only reason I thought of it was because one night, me and my husband coming from outside, oh my gosh, Mom, Dad, the freakiest thing just happened. And we're like, "What?" And she's like, "I came downstairs and she was in the kitchen. And then I see her walk by, so I walk to follow her in her room to see if she's okay. And I see her in her bed sleeping. But she was just walking. So I wanted to make sure that she wasn't tricking me. So, you know, I tried to wake her up, but she was sleeping. She wasn't joking. I think I saw a ghost." And I'm like, Oh crap, Jennifer said there was a little girl in her room. I wonder, you know." So the next day I say to Jennifer, "Jennifer, what does the little girl look like?" And she said, "She has long blonde hair, blue eyes, and she's white. She looks like me." okay, because my daughter had long blonde hair, blue eyes, and I said, is she your age? And she said, no, she's younger than me. She's probably 2 or 3. Now, my daughter was 4.
That's spooky.
So I'm like, holy crap. So, you know, I'm on the phone with my mom and my sisters, and I'm like, I'm freaking out. And I'm like, what the hell do I do? You know? And my sister reminds me, I trash picked that damn dollhouse, like, right when this whole thing started going. But you don't notice little things.
Haunted dollhouse.
I was like, oh my god. I brought a spirit into my house by trash picking this, like, handmade-built dollhouse. I thought it was beautiful. Like, so, and that's the dollhouse the furniture was being arranged in. Her furniture. It didn't come with furniture. I just picked the dollhouse. Anyway, long story short, we ended up burning the dollhouse in the fire pit to try to get rid of the spirit. And then maybe 6 months later, my daughter comes to me and says, oh my gosh, Mom, we burned that little girl's dollhouse, and then she burned our house down. Because we were living in a hotel because our whole entire house burned down. Coincidence or creepy, creepy crawly? I have no idea.
Yeah, I don't think that's a coincidence. Creepy. Look at that cat! That's such a cute cat.
At that moment that I started to wake up, I'm like, wait, someone's running towards me. As I tried to get up, something immediately hit me down, pushing my eyes closed over my chest, and it was holding me down, and it wasn't sleep paralysis, because I kind of felt that before, because I started to hear a whisper.
Still sounds a little bit like sleep paralysis, but that's super scary. But also, that cat is freaking adorable.
This is the longest true horrifying story episode. This episode is worth the time. The story took place in Nador, Morocco, in the year 2015. The story was submitted by Elias. Back in 2015, Elias was an 18-year-old Moroccan Muslim that lived in Norway. One night, Elias was back in Morocco visiting family, and he stayed up late watching a movie at home till 3 in the morning. The living room was very warm, so he got up to open the window for fresh air. As he was at the window, being at the 4th floor in that building, he looks down, and the street was dark and empty, but there was one man wearing black from head to toe with a hood covering his face. He wasn't sure why that man was outside at that time. He looked away, but then peeked one last time out of curiosity. When he looked at him again, the man had his hands on a building's wall. He was strangely just feeling the wall, and out of nowhere, the man vanishes through that wall. He rubbed his eyes in disbelief after what he just witnessed. Elias swears that there was no door in that spot. It was just physically impossible. He forgets about this after a while and then flies back to Norway. 6 months later, in Norway, And Yas experiences his first ever sleep paralysis, which in Islam is known as Jathun. He vividly remembers having a conversation with a dark figure, and his mom also witnessed him speak in his sleep. He woke up after the paralysis with swollen feet and rashes all over his body.
Ow!
And rushed to the ER, and none of the doctors could diagnose what caused his body to react that way. He was finally discharged after treatment, but after that day, Ilyas was never the same person. He always acted differently. He was antisocial. He was distant from people. And his mom always told him that he needed ruqyah. A few months later, they fly back to Morocco for the next holiday season. He was always against his mother's ruqyah idea. However, he decided to fight his thoughts and do it. He had a cousin that was also suffering, and she visited Araku in Morocco quite regularly. So they went together with both of their moms. When they reached, they sat down and waited for their session. Ilyas could hear the raqi in the other room, and he felt extremely uneasy and started to sweat. The Quran recitation, the ruqi, the sounds, made him not even want to look in that direction. He was angry. He went outside for a moment to gain back his senses until their turn finally reached. The raqi called them in and started. Ilyas's cousin immediately started reacting horribly when the Quran started. She was screaming so loud. Ilyas started losing senses throughout his entire body. He was sweating, he was unable to move, and he was shouting from fear. He does pray, and he does read Quran, but he was so confused as to why he was screaming. He felt like he was being tortured. The slightest pinch from the raqi felt like it was a knife stab. It was very powerful. And this is where he felt a jinn's presence inside of him. The following night was the most horrific night for Ilyas. For a whole week, the man was not able to sleep alone, and he would get mentally abused by these demons haunting him. Weeks go by. Ilyas started getting demonic thoughts of harming his own family. He hated everyone. When he would look at his own sister, her face would seem distorted to him. He knows these beings are playing with his head. His whole life turned upside down. He would regularly think of harming his own family, but luckily, he never did. A few months later, Ilyas was back in Norway, and life was back to normal. He was relieved that he was in a good state of mind and that the horror was over. At the time, he worked at a local grocery store. After a Christmas celebration at work, which he did not participate in, it was late at night. He was walking one of his colleagues back home from work. She was a young woman, and she was scared to walk alone. After they reached outside her place, she asked him, "Where's that other girl that was with us?" "What girl?" Ilyas asked. "There was no one there. It was just you and I." She swore that there was another woman with black hair, pale skin, standing next to him the whole time, staring at Ilyas's colleague with anger. Even though this entity gave Ilyas a break, this jinn was still around, haunting everyone that has intentions towards Ilyas.
Spooky. Also, everybody's in the comments saying, "Oh, the images are too scary." I didn't see anything wrong with the images, like, but I've seen a lot worse. Oh yeah, we've seen this one with the creepy guy that just shows up. There he is. Yes, that's good advice. Lock your doors for real, people. Is that like the Alexa? Joe Rogan. I thought demonologist said dermatologist, and I was like, what the fuck would a dermatologist do in that situation? But that's what I thought it said. Oh, jeez. I'm getting some shit confused today.
An underground coal miner was nearing the end of his shift, waiting for the next crew to arrive on site. He just happened to look across his machinery to see a man standing there, staring at him. He was just about to speak when he realized that this guy was certainly not on his crew. His helmet light was emitting no light and was in fact an old carbide lamp, not like his battery power. All he wanted to do was run away, but he was rooted to the spot, looking at him. As he was about to open his mouth and scream, the figure turned 90 degrees and began walking along the side of the machine. With every step he took, the man would sink lower and lower into the ground. The worker finally snapped out of his daze and ran around the other side to see no one there. Maybe he was hallucinating, or maybe it was something unexplainable. Ghost. He wrote the time and date on the wall to help recall when and where he saw this, returning to that spot many times, hoping to see him again. He never did. An underground coal miner.
I'm talking about living with my dad, and he was living his double life. So, my parents divorced in 1980, and when they got married, she was the last three kids. I'm older. My dad moves in with his former mistress into her house in Florida. This is the house we grew up to. Thank you.
bless my soul. Interesting. So her dad was a murderer? An unaliver, I guess? Not cool.
The picture behind me might look like a normal photo, but it's actually one of the most sinister, real-life haunted photos in history. Taken by a professional photographer in 1972 as guests arrived for a wedding, everything in this picture looks happy and normal. But if you take a closer look at the man standing in black, you'll see something odd. You can actually see somebody in white crouching behind the man. All four of the people in the picture said that there was no one behind them when it was taken. The photographer said the same thing and that it would be impossible for someone to crouch behind them without him seeing them. This is a better picture where you can actually see the guy's legs, and then in the top you can see his eyes. The picture was even examined by police photographers and they confirmed that it was genuine.
Creepy. That's so weird when stuff like that happens, and it's like harder to fake with like the older pictures. Plus, where's the dude's butt? Where's his booty? Or do you think it's one of those things where they faked the picture like hundreds of years ago and they were like, they're gonna wonder how we did this like so many years ago. They're gonna think it's a ghost. That would be hilarious if they were, like, trolling us back in the, like, I don't know, however long ago this was.
This story that I'm about to read you guys has to be one of the top 10 scariest stories that I've ever read in my entire life. And let me mention that, yes, all of this is true. Naomi said that throughout her childhood, she lived in Puerto Rico, and she had a house that was built with all cement, 4 bedrooms, 1 bathroom, had wired fences outside her house, as well as no central AC. She said all this would be important for later on in the story. In the year 1998, Naomi's mom bought her brand new first home for her and her kids. She had just been divorced, being a single mom, so this right here was a huge milestone for her. The house was big and had lots of space for her and her younger brother to play and grow up in. Naomi says since her mom was a child, she had the ability to see demons, and in church, she would basically use that power to call. call out on demons on people. She also stated that when she was 4 years old, her mom stated that she would always see these entities as well, but Naomi doesn't recall. Now, Naomi doesn't see spirits, but she can definitely feel and hear them. Since the first night they moved into the house, Naomi felt a tall, dark figure in the front of her bedroom door. The dark figure would never enter her room, but he would walk around the kitchen that happened to be right in front of her bedroom door. She was never the type to close the door when she would sleep, so she would have the door wide open and she would always feel his presence. Due to the fact that she doesn't like closing the door while she sleeps, she ended up having to buy a nightlight to make herself feel a little bit more safer. But she says whenever that nightlight would turn off, she would feel really dread and feel paralyzed. She would also sweat profusely and until her mom would come in or bring her a candle. Throughout her childhood, teenhood, and adulthood, she would always constantly feel this person walking outside her bedroom door. And when Naomi had the courage to actually finally tell the spirit to leave her alone, he eventually would, and that's when she would be able to go to sleep. But like I said, this continued throughout her whole childhood. So some nights would be peaceful, other nights would be pure dread. He was there every single night and only left whenever Naomi told him to. A couple years go by, Naomi is now 21 years old and she decides that she needs something new. So she decides to get a dog. Now her dog would sleep with her and would eventually make her feel safer at night. At night, whenever Naomi feels that same dreadful feeling, her dog would always bark at her bedroom door. First time her dog did it, she knew she was not crazy and it was never in Naomi's head. Her dog basically confirmed to her that what Naomi had been going through her whole childhood was real. Stay tuned for part two. This story.
Well, I hope there is a part two to that. But we're going to leave it here. Maybe in the next video we'll find part two and we'll hear the rest of that story. But for now, I'm going to say my goodbyes to you. Don't forget to like and subscribe for more videos. Don't forget to share with your friends and family. I'm Danny Paranormal and I will miss you when I'm gone. So, I hope you guys miss me too. Thank you so much for subscribing to my YouTube channel if you already subscribed. And I'll see you in the next one. Bye!